welcome to the second day of the Combating Racism and Antisemitism, Shaping an Omni-American Future event. I'm your host, Lauren Izzo. We are really excited to have you back with us today as we continue our journey exploring the power of culture to fight racism and antisemitism, which are both plaguing contemporary American society. Okay, now to a religious perspective by Zainab Zeb Khan, the head of the Muslim American Leadership Alliance. A recent article in Newsweek magazine that she co-authored with ASF Executive Director Jason Guberman reads beautifully within an Omni-American context. By working together over the last 5 years, they write, has taught them important lessons about overcoming difference and shaping an agenda of tolerance rooted in deep pride in our unique identities, as well as a commitment to all that we share. It's given us a blueprint for how we recommit to pluralism without sacrificing difference, identity, or history. And it's a lesson that could not be more important in an America where intolerance is rising on both sides of the political spectrum. Thank you so much for joining us, Zainab.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. And thank you, Jason, for inviting me to speak on this conference. As a Muslim American born and raised here, I have quite a bit to share. This is a wonderful and incredible and very timely topic, combating anti-Semitism and racism. It goes hand in hand with also the Muslim experience, the Muslim American experience. And I just wanted to tie into our previous speakers. There's so much that I've learned just from reading the Omni-American, and lots of parallels with the heart of heroism, the antagonistic cooperation of the hero, which kind of goes back into, it reminds me of Viktor Frankl's words of idealism is our best realism. And that goes back to purpose and experience. And hence, then again, it goes into Carl Jung, which is archetypes and symbolisms as a reflection of our experiences. So personal experiences are, of course, what shape us to social policies. And so given that Muslim Americans perhaps are the most diverse minority in the United States, from different demographic backgrounds, whether you're looking at socioeconomic, educational status, ethnicity, whether you're looking at first generation to fourth generation. Nonetheless, we have been continuing in our battle similar to that other minority groups and being boxed into either political or theological categories. And I'll kind of give an example where I think nowadays, and when we look at newsrooms, campuses, and institutions, Islamist organizations, which are ruled by the Islamist doctrine, which go against liberal and democratic values, their organizations and pundits have set the tone for much of Muslim American culture and political life. And this includes giving little to no room for opposing views, being supportive of Israel or being supportive of American Jewish organizations that support Israel. This creates a scarlet letter and brands individuals into categories such as bad Muslims or Muslims that are to be suspicious of. And what this also does is it ties in, I think, to modern day, what it is it's a steady stream of cancel culture and ostracizing and labeling, which in its own paradox, it reveals a very profound illiberal ruling ideology. And that to me comes as a major surprise, given that the majority of Muslim Americans come from closed societies where democracy is unattainable, it's unreachable, and it's, you know, we're seeing the perfect example of it, of what's going on in Afghanistan today. And really, I think it's almost a paradox, because the desire for equality is not enough. You know, group identity must come first and individual second. So being a Muslim American means that you have to essentially be anti-Israel, anti-Jewish, anti-American, to recognize the progress that America has made in half a century since the end of legal segregation. It doesn't even matter if we look at how far along our country has come. Muslims without an anti-American agenda are also part of racism and white supremacy. So, for example, I've seen this many times of people that have mentioned their own personal stories that even serving in the military has caused them pain, because as a Muslim American, how could they fight in Iraq or in Afghanistan being Muslim and serving America? Given that kind of differences in ideology and categorizing people, I kind of want to go back into what a beautiful example how arts and cultures thrived before such categorized identities is the golden era of Bollywood, where Jewish, Muslim, Parsi, Hindu, and Europeans all led the silver screen and the blueprint for the entertainment media. Sadly, though, that example and that plethora of tolerance and acceptance is not possible now due to Islamists, nationalists, and fundamentalists. We've seen the Buddhist culture be erased in Afghanistan. We've seen Bollywood become very politicized if there are Muslim actors. And I just kind of want to go into how the two of the women that really, really made this kind of possibility were Pramila and Nadira, which can be played in a short video. There's a wonderful film on the Jews in Bollywood and how four women led the screen and the era of the golden age of Bollywood.
Esther Victoria Abraham, better known by her stage name Pramila, was a pageant girl turned actress. She was the first ever winner of the Miss India pageant in 1947, cementing her name in history outside of the acting world as well. Her family, like Sue Luciano, was of the Baghdadi Jewish community who settled in India. Her foray into acting started with her cousin, another famous actress of the time, Rose Ezra.
We have a choice, and that choice is to either look back and to learn the lessons from history, and to break the narrative of categorizations that are placed in the mainstream media and cause further divisions and segregations, which then leads to hate and racism, a paradigm of us versus them. So thank you for allowing me to share my thoughts.
Wonderful. Thank you, Zainab, for joining us and being a really important voice in our discussion today. We really appreciate it.
Of course. Thank you.
And now for yet another jazz story, of course, this one told by my co-host, Aryeh Tepper, director of publications and chief editor at the American Sephardi Federation, and another of this event's organizers, focusing on the years 1938 and 39, when jazz was breaking down barriers in the United States while resisting racist Nazis in Europe. Aryeh?
Thank you, Lauren. If you wanted to trace the different political trajectories of the United States and Nazi Germany in 1938, all you had to do was follow the jazz. In the United States, 1938 saw the famous Carnegie Hall concert featuring Benny Goodman's orchestra with stars from the Count Basie and Duke Ellington bands. The show was a milestone in 20th century American artistic and social history. Jazz was performed at Carnegie Hall, until then the exclusive province of classical music. People were becoming aware of the deep life in this music. And a stage was provided for social cultural integration with black, Jewish, and white musicians playing jazz together, and Lauren's getting into it right here. Goodman bravely broke through the color line on the bandstand, and it was a breakthrough moment in cultural history, a vision of the future. 25 years later, King would lead the march on Washington, D.C. Germany? 1938 was the year of the Nazis' public exhibition dedicated to un-Aryan degenerate music. Who makes degenerate music? Jewish composers like Alban Berg, Arnold Schoenberg, and Kurt Weill. And the poster chosen by the Nazis to represent the exhibition? Well, it featured a well-dressed black man portrayed as a monkey playing a saxophone with the Star of David on his lapel. Grotesque. The Nazis, pursuing their insane ideal of racial purity, were purging Germany of everything black and Jewish. This meant jazz. At least, that's what they wanted to do. The 1993 film Swing Kids told the story of German youth who, even under the Nazis, loved Benny Goodman and Duke Ellington. In the movie, the human spirit of swing is so strong that it empowers a German youth to resist the Nazis. It's also a true story. The Swing Youth were a group of German anti-Nazi jazz lovers who came together in Hamburg in 1939. That's right. Jazz was the source of an internal German anti-Nazi counterculture. And as swing kid Friedrich Ritzel said in a 1985 interview, everything for us was a world of great longing. Western life, democracy, everything was connected and connected through jazz. Jazz is both a source of life and a model of democratic community. And in 1938 and 1939, jazz was celebrated by the lovers of democracy and excellence, both in the United States and Germany.
Thank you, Aryeh, for that. On that note, I'll turn it over to Itamar Borokhov and his quartet once again and let them show you just what we're talking about. Gentlemen. Thank you. Welcome back to all of our viewers. Now, in our next section, a democratic Omni-American future, we'll get a closer look at the democratic ideals envisioned for society by Albert Murray. Greg, please lead the way.
Glad to. I want to bring together some of the threads that we've heard in the last 2 days, and particularly today, by focusing on an influence on Albert Murray and also on Ralph Ellison. The man's name is Kenneth Burke, and he is known for his work on rhetoric. He's focused on in the field of communications theory. And I'd like to share with you a book based on Kenneth Burke's work called Civic Jazz, American Music and Kenneth Burke on the Art of Getting Along. So let me just share some thoughts. According to Gregory Clark, the author of this book, Civic Jazz, he's a university professor of English at Brigham Young University. And he says that jazz is the quintessential democratic art, which creates human experiences of civic form in action. Form, according to Kenneth Burke, and this bears the influence of John Dewey's meditation on form in his book, Art and Experience, form isn't just based on the artifact. An individual or audience of readers, listeners, and viewers co-create the form by their experience of the art and artifact. The experience of art is cultural and symbolic, with the potential to move us from one state of mind and consciousness and attitude to another as we engage in and with it. This is akin to the way we are carried along by the experience of a plot in the story, as Rabbi Buskila and Nick Janka were talking about, or by the syncopated rhythms of jazz. So this is a quote from Gregory Clark in Civic Jazz. In Kenneth Burke's concept, the rhetorical and the aesthetic, argument and art, necessarily combine. And in America, they combine in the project of shaping individuals in the image of interdependent independence that follows from the civic ideal of E pluribus unum. That so many Americans seem unwilling to claim that interdependence along with their independence, even to admit it, has always been this nation's basic civic problem. Now, Walt Whitman, the great poet, 19th century American poet, after the Civil War, he understandably his faith in democracy after the Civil War was shaken. And Whitman, in what Greg Clark calls a long and moody essay, Democratic Vistas, looked beyond political democracy to what Whitman called a social or aesthetic democracy for a moral and artistic identity. Whitman's own poetry invited audiences into an experience of shared identity at Americans, but arguably only with the creation of jazz does one have the moral and aesthetic reenactment of American democratic principles and collective improvisation, where the individual is respected and acknowledged while the group strives for that ensemble mindset we call swing. Clark would agree with this, and he would extend the point even further, where he said, "Perhaps jazz is the music of democracy, not so much because it so well melds individual and group, freedom and order, though that is crucial, but because it does through joint acts of faith. Jazz musicians play the music upon the belief that something beyond themselves will be manifest there. Something that expresses, in William James's phrase, quote, immense elation and surrender, as in the outlines of confining selfhood melt down. Now, if the call for joint acts of faith has a religious ring to it, that's okay. As Beth Eady demonstrates in her book, The Rights of Identity, the religious naturalism and cultural criticism of Kenneth Burke and Ralph Ellison, Both Burke and one of his most perceptive interpreters, Ellison, were concerned with, quote, religious traditions and experiences as naturally available to human beings without the attribution of any special supernatural powers to any human ideals, end quote. Burke and Ellison were like anthropologists of language, highlighting how the linguistic dimension is the site of contention over sacred meaning, with what Ellison called antagonistic cooperation, pointing to democratic differentiation and unity at the same time. John Dewey once wrote that the primary tenet of an authentic American civic religion was, quote, the continual disclosing of truth through directed cooperative endeavor, end quote. And riffing on Dewey, Clark wrote, religion is about transcendence, and E Pluribus Unum is an inspiration, is an aspiration as transcendent as any. Religion is also about sacrifice, and jazz music can show us the kind of cooperation that demands a profound sacrifice of self, the kind in which a better self can sometimes be discovered. And this is how jazz, Clark writes, is intensely rhetorical in the very way religion is. Its project is to prompt others to progress beyond selfishness by enabling them to comprehend in themselves a person whom joining with others might let them become. And like religion, jazz draws upon the resources of rhetoric and aesthetics to let those who experience it experience that self rationally and emotionally, systematically and intuitively all at once. So this is my intro to why jazz and democracy are so closely tied together, based on the work of Kenneth Burke, Ralph Ellison, and also our main focus, the person of Albert Murray.
What a really fascinating perspective. Thank you so much for that, Greg. We really appreciate it. Now we have with us philosopher, psychologist, and educator Zach Stein to speak on the post-tragic blues sensibility. Mr. Stein, welcome, and please take it away.
Hey, thank you very much. Yeah, I'm going to, if Greg spoke about how there's a relationship between democracy and jazz, I think there's a relationship between democracy and the blues as well. And I'm going to weave that together by speaking about this notion of what I call post-tragic consciousness. And the basic idea here is that, democracy isn't about winning. Democracy is actually about losing, how you handle loss. And this wonderful book by Danielle Allen, Talking to Strangers, where she articulates that. She says, we have this misunderstanding that democracy is about forming a consensus and getting everyone to believe the same thing, when in fact it's about handling opposition and creating a situation of cooperative opposition. And what that means is that we need to be able to lose well, and we need to be able to understand that life actually is woven through with loss. Democracy, unlike other forms of government that strive for a certain kind of perfection, democracy, as it comes from Athens and the Greeks in some ways, although you could trace it to other roots, democracy is about a certain inherent open loop in the human condition, a certain tragic structure. So as a psychologist, I think about how we transform from little babies in a crib to becoming children, to becoming adolescents, to adults, to old age. And there's many ways to think about that. One way to think about it is in terms of the stations that the personality might go through. And so I talk often about the pre-tragic personality. And the pre-tragic personality believes we can get everyone to agree. Right? The pre-tragic personality is a kind of a tragic hero, a kind of comedic hero, where you get the girl at the end and everything works out. This is the pre-tragic consciousness. And then there's a tragic consciousness when the illusions of childhood are stripped away and you realize that there's an inherent tragic structure to existence itself, that the very country we live in, the laws that we abide by were written in blood, and et cetera. And so, you can get trapped in tragic consciousness and not escape from tragic consciousness. But what the blues musicians teach us, and we can sit as apprentices at the foot of blues musicians on this point, is that there's a way out of the tragic to the post-tragic. And Albert Murray in his book, The Hero and the Blues, I'll hold up a book here too. Albert Murray in his book, The Hero and the Blues, lays out very articulately the nature of that post-tragic consciousness. It is not one that resolves tragedy, right? The way out of tragedy is not to make it so there isn't tragedy. It's to learn how to live with tragedy. He uses the metaphor of the creation of a sword, right? The fire that makes the metal malleable does not destroy it. It eventually hardens its battle edge. So we learn to be again in cooperative opposition to the circumstances. The tragic hero, classically in tragedy, and this is what Albert Murray discusses in this book, Hemingway and the Greeks, and then of course also through to Thomas Mann. What you find in the tragic hero is not a resolution of tragedy, in fact, but a living with tragedy, a transcending tragedy from within. And so the invitation, essentially, to democracy at this moment is to not fall into the trap of demanding consensus and conformity in a time of great complexity, but rather to learn to live in cooperative opposition and to work with a form of post-tragic consciousness that accepts loss as an inherent part of the human condition, that accepts illness, sickness, death as an inherent part of the human condition. These are things that the psyche inevitably deals with as it matures. People without means, people on the short end of the stick, people like the blues musicians understood this well. And so that's how we can learn from the blues idioms and from blues as an emergent property of American culture, as an emergent property of American democracy. We can learn from it to help save democracy in a time of crisis, in a time when we're regressing back to pre-tragic forms of perfection. We're getting stuck in a kind of postmodern tragic overwhelm and re-traumatization. So the transcendence through tragedy is what we're seeking, and the establishment of a cooperative opposition. And so that's this notion of the post-tragic consciousness as a way to learn from the blues and as a way to reconfigure the notion of democracy, not about winning, but democracy about losing. And similarly with life, that we live towards dying instead of pretending to perfect our lives here. So I'll end on that note. I hadn't been keeping track of the time, but it's a pleasure to speak with you. I appreciate the time and attention of everyone.
Thank you very much for that.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Zach, for your time and your thoughts. We really appreciate it. Now, as a writer, Murray composed nonfiction, fiction, and poetry. Joining us next to share some rare Murray poetry is scholar Paul Devlin, an expert on the work of Murray and his friend Ralph Ellison. In fact, in November, Cambridge University Press will publish Ralph Ellison in Context, edited by Professor Devlin. What can you tell us about what we're going to hear?
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to read from some of Murray's posthumously published poems. These are poems that were published in 2018. I had a role in getting these poems into print, which I will discuss after I read them. And incidentally, my name is Paul Devlin, Associate Professor of English at the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy and Book Review Editor of African American Review. So four of these five poems are untitled, so I will just make a pause in between reading them. While some, circa 1940 through 45, took actual flight training ranging from Piper Cub solos through BT-11s, AT-6s, P-40s to F-51s, Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker developed make-believe bird wings. And when jets and space missiles eventually arrived, we were ready for them. It was only a matter of segue. The magic keys. Some sharp, some flat, some natural. the readiness is all. Some golden, some silver, some platinum. Some of some as yet undisclosed alloy. There were 50 roads to town, which was 7 blue miles away. 7 or 7 times 7 plus 1 mile creek. 70 times 7 plus the 7 seas. What can I do and not do about the cosmic implications of the ancient Roman still life exhibition at Vesuvius? You can proceed as if it all mattered, but so much for the 7 cardinal sins, so much for crime and punishment. When tomorrow becomes today, and also what is left of yesterday, we say now, which is the ongoing in which we live, and without which there is no past and no future. So those are my selections from Mr. Murray's posthumously published poetry. Moselle Murray died in 2015, 2 years after Al. Shortly thereafter, I was asked to supervise the cataloging of Murray's library, music collection, and archive in an effort to secure the transfer of his books, papers, and artifacts to institutional homes, mainly to Harvard for books and papers, and to Tuskegee for books and artifacts, while Indiana University also has a few books. Simultaneously, I was working as co-editor of the Library of America volumes of Murray's work and writing the chronology, note on the text, and notes found in those volumes. In the process, I discovered a bunch of poems scattered across notebooks and on loose paper. We know from South to a Very Old Place that Murray was writing poetry since at least the 1960s, and there is suggestive evidence that he was writing poetry in the 1950s. Like his early one-act plays from the 1930s and much of his early fiction, no copies survive. I think these posthumously published poems are among his most sparely elegant and coolly philosophical. I'm so glad that he preserved them for us. Should anyone wish to read the poems Murray published in his lifetime, they are in the volume titled Conjugations and Reiterations, published in 2001, and also included in the Library of America edition, Albert Murray Collected Novels and Poems. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Paul. And Paul, thank you for doing you, which includes, you know, finding these poems and bringing them to our attention. And I'll have I'm going to always feel gratitude, Paul, because you introduced me to Mr. Murray, and you also introduced me to Mr. Greg Thomas, and you do Paul Devlin. So just, you know, great luck with your upcoming book, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much,
Mr. Devlin. Thank you. Now, we'll close this section the way we began it, with a focus on Murray's democratic ideas. We've asked Jonathan Silver, editor of Mosaic Magazine, and John Wood Jr., the national ambassador of the Braver Angels organization, to discuss Omni-American culture and the American future. Each was provided a copy of an interview from Murray Talks Music, a volume edited by Paul Devlin with foreword by Gary Giddens, and afterwards by our own Greg Thomas. Welcome, John and John.
John Silver and John Wood, welcome.
Good to be with you guys.
Wonderful. John Silver, please take it away.
Okay, so thanks. My name is Jonathan Silver. I'm the editor of Mosaic and a magazine of Jewish ideas and public affairs, the host of the Tikva podcast. I'm really happy to be sitting with John Wood of Better Angels. John, our charge is to discuss this conversation, this interview that the American critic Albert Murray gave to Russell Neff back in 1990. I'd not known about this interview until preparing for this discussion today, but I thought it actually taught me 3 big things about America and American citizenship. Here's what I learned. The first thing is that Murray says we're in danger of losing a command of language, and that means a loss of precision in dealing with actuality, in dealing with the facts of life. And that always means, that always puts us in trouble. It puts our civilization in trouble. Now, the capacity for articulate speech is the tool that we have to describe the world, its majesty and its misery, to one another and to ourselves. The corruption of language has civilizational consequences. And I think that the place in our culture now where language games are being played with consequences that we cannot possibly foreknow is in the domain of sex and gender. And I don't know how a culture can recover from replacing the word mother with the phrase birthing person. Now, the fact of the matter is that every single woman and man walking this earth was born from a sort of miracle that biological science can observe and describe, but not fully explain. And in that mystery, something distinctive and precious points to women. And if we lose that precision, we lose something important. But I want to note that Murray's point here has special relevance for us as a democratic citizenry, because we come to understand our own thoughts, he seems to be saying, through the very relational act of communicating together. The second big point, losing our tradition means losing our way. Tradition, neither for Murray or for me, does not mean just believing in every particular of what our ancestors believe. It's not about recapitulating the past. For Murray, tradition is necessary for reform and innovation. It is for elaborating something new. So how can the past be used for something new is a kind of puzzle. And I think that he solves that puzzle because for Murray, tradition conveys from the past to the future something he called in the interview forms. It is, he writes, a basic principle of dealing with life that should underlie all art forms. And we need an adequate thing to emulate to fulfill our potential. Now, this is one of the great practical lessons that music teaches to school children all across our country. If you don't know your scales and the chord progressions that underlie all of our melody, you will be literally inarticulate. And I think Murray challenges us to wonder if the same forms that animate music at its best also might animate democratic civic life at its best. And if we need to master the forms of the blues to say something articulate, let alone intelligent, about jazz, in jazz, we need maybe to master democracy's forms in order to say something articulate in our common civic life. The third big thing that I learned from Murray's interview is that the way he understands the difficulties and the obstacles that are inherent in human life. Now, these obstacles are not evenly distributed, and neither are human talents. But just as every person on this earth has some kind of talent, so every person on this earth also have things in their life that they have to overcome. That is unavoidable and inescapable. And here is Murray's comment on that fact. There's some kind of majestic human potential that is made manifest in overcoming hard things that happen in life. I think this is the fundamental assumption of the poetry of the blues. And it is what I think Murray means when he advises that instead of saying in the face of a difficulty, why should this happen to me? He instead would recommend that we say, what am I going to do about this situation? To me, these are the three great points from Albert Murray. And I think they amount to some very wise counsel for us as democratic citizens.
Well, that's an extraordinary overview, Mr. Silver. And I think that you really do capture some essential dimensions within which, if we are truly going to embrace an omni-American future, we need to find ourselves sort of deeply in touch with. By the way, you came very close to quoting Dave Chappelle on your first point, I noted, about motherhood and language. So I thought that was interesting to pluck out. I'm a person who, was raised on a bandstand in a family that you might essentially describe as omni-American. My father is Anglo-American from the South, white jazz pianist. My mother's an R&B singer, African-American from inner city Los Angeles. Music was the tie that brought my family together. The frictions in broader American culture served as tensions in my own home, which, did a fair amount to, I think, pull my family apart a bit. So, I've sung the blues in the context of my own familial experience, just as we all have in the context of American democracy. But there is a resilience in the blues, in jazz, that is in touch with the deep exploration of the human spirit in the context of living, in the context of overcoming heartbreak, tragedy, that makes tragedy, in reference to one of our previous speakers' observation, sort of, you know, a fair kind of marker by which to anchor our understanding of the true character of democracy, insofar as democracy is meant to help us not just celebrate victories so much, it's not really the chief purpose there, but rather to sort of anchor human endeavor in a way to where even when we have failed, we are failing towards something, towards some greater progress, and towards some greater relationship and connection with one another. Because as we come in the process of dialectic to be able to articulate the things that we believe, we are push to be able to understand ourselves better, to share of our soul gifts, if you will, with others in dialogue in a way that enriches our understanding of the society we share and of the kinship that we share in being members of a given society, right? And so this sort of tilts into the idea of form a bit, the idea that it is in form that we discover our character. And so, you know, the scholar Yuval Levin writes about the sort of decline of the American social fabric and our ability to relate the context of democracy in the modern day by noting the fact that while we still have institutions, the idea that institutions help give form to the virtues and characters of the people within them so that they may serve a greater good in the context of society, that, you know, that the establishment of the law and the courts is meant to form an ethos of justice and integrity, that the form of the university is meant to give shape to the virtues of objectivity and the pursuit of truth in scholarship, that we do not put ourselves over and above the form in which we occupy in an institutional context, because that gives birth to a fruit of character that is meant to be shared throughout society, more than just our own personal self-aggrandizement. That metaphor for formation is so extraordinarily captured, you know, in the idea that in the musical context, in the musical structure, we, even if we take a solo, do not rise above the band, so to speak, but have our place within the ensemble. And so there's this way in which a proper understanding of democracy is one that rests itself in an anchoring of a certain sort of humility, wherein even if you have a particular line that you are meant to play and a particular moment to shine, you realize that is given value only in the context of the dialogue of all of the other voices that takes place in the music that is sounding forth. And so when we think about this idea of the Omni-American, when we think about this idea of an American experience that it's the product of so many different perspectives and pains and histories and tragedies, but also triumphs and overcomings, joining streams like tributaries into a mighty river, it is proper to sort of think about this in a musical frame that allows for even dissonance between notes to be a part of the greater sort of beauty of musical expression. And so part of what Murray talked about was the sort of flexibility that comes with jazz that is, you know, sort of a little bit different than you have in other musical traditions, where every note has to be played precisely as it is written on the page. And if you fail to do so, maybe you're not executing your craft properly. But in jazz, there is room for an improvisation in which something that seems like a faulty note introducing a point of dissonance can actually resolve its tension in the course of further play, in the course of further exploration. And again, the analogy to the way democracy truly is striking, because in democracy, in the context of self-government, where we enter into dialogue with one another, we inevitably experience tensions between our experiences, between our perspectives and points of view. But there is a growing together, which is the premise of our sharing in the project of self-governance, which is, in essence, that dissonance achieving resolution over time, right? And so it is a remarkable opportunity from my vantage point to be a part of a larger conversation with individuals like yourself, Mr. Thomas, and so many others, who are giving articulation to this phenomenon, this musical character and personality of American democracy, in a way that can begin to restore the precision of language by which we come to understand not only the nature of the American project, but the nature of ourselves as individuals in relationship to one another and community as a part of it. And I just couldn't be any more thrilled than I am to be able to play a small part in contributing my own few notes to this honoring of the legacy of Albert Murray and this vision of the Omni-American as we continue it here into the future.
All right, John, if you have nothing to respond, we're going to have to end that there. Thank you so much, both of you, for being a part of our discussion today. Well, as we come to a close of our first annual Combating Racism and Anti-Semitism, Shaping an Omni-American Future event, we'd like Aryeh Tepper to address this question, my co-host, of course, right beside me. Does our gathering over the past 2 days signify the possibility of a new chapter in the story of Jewish and Black American cultural exchange? Excuse me. Aryeh, what do you think?
Well, that's a great question, Lauren. And in order to try and answer it, let's step back for a second. It's been more than 50 years since the political progress of the civil rights movement, but some Americans on both the right and the left are still thinking in racial categories. Old school racists on the right, progressive race theorists on the left, have been enchanted by an idol of the mind that magically reduces people to soulless categories. Throughout this event, we've been stating and restating a basic truth. Race is a soulless category that tells us nothing about the person standing before us. The richness of a person's life is a function of his or her culture, not race. Yes, it's been 50 plus years since the glorious progress of the civil rights movement, but the pressure is intensifying again to think in terms of race and racial essentialism. Now, what's the best way to grasp the monumental character of the Omni-American blues idiom wisdom tradition? That deep flow of spirited soulfulness and sensitive intelligence that animates the work of Albert Murray, as well as Ralph Ellison, Duke Ellington, Mary Lou Williams, Dizzy Gillespie, and so many others. How's this? It's the cultural complement to the political progress of the civil rights movement, back when we used to talk about the content of people's character. You see, when you focus on character, you're thinking in terms of human excellence. You're living on the level of your consciousness in the realm where the individual truly matters, irrespective of color or ethnicity or anything else. So the new chapter in Black Jewish cultural exchange isn't really a matter of progress. Instead, it's a kind of return, a return to democratic fundamentals, to the basics, a return and rededication to the democratic consciousness to which the founders aspired when they shared the dream of a natural aristocracy determined by virtue and talent, as opposed to an artificial aristocracy founded on wealth and birth and all kinds of other crazy ideas. The American founders didn't get there themselves, but to appropriate the words of Stanley Crouch, the deeper meaning of democracy remains the same, that nobility shows up where it feels like showing up, and that can be just about anywhere. But there's reason for optimism. The return to this noble democratic sensibility, the receptivity to and celebration of human excellence, wherever it feels like showing up, is continually transmitted through what Murray called the fully orchestrated blues statement, jazz. That's right, the return to the noble democratic consciousness of a natural aristocracy is transmitted through jazz. As in, it doesn't matter where you come from, can you swing with the collective, but also communicate in your own distinctive voice? Can you play? Jazz was invented by Black Americans, but anyone with humility, talent, and dedication can learn the vocabulary. In the immortal words of the great jazz trumpeter Miles Davis, I don't care if a dude is purple with green breath as long as he can swing. If there's one novel aspect to this chapter in Jewish and American cultural exchange, perhaps it lies in the conscious appeal to jazz as a wisdom tradition, because at its best, jazz is more than just historically rich and aesthetically pleasurable, although it surely is both of those. Jazz is also a source of wisdom. And to explore that wisdom a little bit And to expand and elaborate the wisdom in a couple of intriguing directions, I'm going to talk with my friend, the great Israel-born and Brooklyn-based jazz musician, Itamar Borokhov. Itamar, thanks for being with us, and thanks for bringing your wonderful quartet. It's great to have you here. Let me start, first of all, tell us briefly, give us a 30-second musical biography.
Well, I was born in Israel, grew up in the city of Jaffa. I started playing at the age of 3. I started playing trumpet at the age of 12. My father is a musician, my brother is a musician, and I fell in love with jazz in my teens. Decided to immerse myself in this musical, to learn the musical language, and then to immerse myself in its culture. Mm-hmm. Ended up moving to New York. Mm-hmm. I went to school at New School University. Mm-hmm. And have been living there for the past 14 years.
Okay, now, you've mentioned previously, and we mentioned this in the liner notes to Boomerang, but you had a very powerful experience when you listened to Miles Davis's Sketches of Spain. It was an experience, you experienced greatness, and you interpreted that greatness in a certain way. Could you tell us about that?
Yeah, you know, I started playing trumpet, and my mother actually went out to the record store when we still had those, mm-hmm. and said, oh, my son plays trumpet, can you give me something? And they gave her 2 Miles Davis records, Kind of Blue and Sketches of Spain. Mm. When I listened to Sketches of Spain for the first time, it was way above what I could, way above my level, but I felt it's something great. I didn't know what they were playing, but I knew it made me feel like I'm in the presence of something truly great. And I think this is what we talked about then. And something that I think about, that greatness is a force that cannot be ignored.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so greatness as being a force that can't be ignored and aspiring to that greatness, I guess that led you to on your journey to become a first rate, to really learn and master the bebop tradition. And you went to New York and you immersed yourself. And then you had this very pivotal moment when one of your instructors, Nathan Davis, said, well, if you want to be a jazz musician in the full sense, it's not just a matter of learning the technical vocabulary. It's something, there's another element among other elements that's very important.
Right. What Nathan told me, he told me, we want you to be you. And that sentence really resonated with me and stuck with me for a long time. I think what he was trying to say is, okay, this goes beyond mimicking. This, if you want to reach really, you know, the next level, you need to go within yourself and to bring something that is authentically yours, mm-hmm. Within the form of this tradition that you respect.
Yeah, that's very powerful, and I think you're being recognized for that. When you received the Rising Stars Jazz Award, Dee Dee Bridgewater remarked upon this distinctive voice of yours that connects Jaffa to, let's call it Manhattan and Central Asia all at one time, and it comes out as Itamar Borokhov. So best of luck to you on your continued quest for greatness in your own voice, and thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much also. And I have to say, the music that's coming from you guys today has really made this broadcast, made our show. So thank you very much.
I'm very honored. Thank you.
And now to present the first annual Omni-American Youth Leader Award, let's welcome back Jason Guberman, social entrepreneur and executive director of the American Sephardi Federation, which played a vital role in making this event happen.
The Jazz Leadership Project, American Sephardi Federation, and the Combat Anti-Semitism Movement are pleased to present our inaugural Omni-American Young Leader Award to U.S. Representative Richie Torres, who proudly represents New York's 15th Congressional District. This honor is given in recognition of Congressman Torres's work as a civic and political leader, his courageous support of the sovereign right of our liberal, pluralistic ally Israel to defend itself against its illiberal enemies, and his resonance with the legacy of the late Black American thinker Albert Murray. Murray coined the phrase Omni-American to signify the pluralistic cultural dynamic of American life. The cultural and ethnic diversity of Congressman Torres's background, his Bronx constituency, and his dedication to liberal democratic principles are shining examples of what Murray had in mind. Congressman Torres's friendship, which is deep and heartfelt with the Jewish community and state, moreover, continues the noble tradition of civil rights leaders A. Philip Randolph and Bayard Rustin. Their organization, BASIC, Black Americans Support Israel Committee, with the support of Rosa Parks, John Lewis, Jackie Robinson, Count Basie, Ralph Ellison, and many others, fought anti-Semitism and racism, championed freedom for Soviet Jewry, as well as the Aliyah of Ethiopian Jews. We look forward to Congressman Torres's continued good work on behalf of his constituents and indeed all of humanity.
Thank you so much, Jason. We now have the privilege of having Congressman Torres join us to accept this award and share his thoughts on the Omni-American idea in a short interview. Congressman Torres, welcome and thank you for joining us today.
It's an honor to be here. And thank you for the honor.
Of course. Now, Albert Murray's idea of an Omni-American culture envisions America as a society in which people of different backgrounds can freely absorb the best of each other's culture and connect to each other's common humanity. What role, Mr. Torres, can politicians and politics play to help Mr. Murray's vision a reality?
Well, those of us in elected office have an obligation to defend the core value that lies at the heart of the American experiment. Which is diversity. The United States is the first modern republic, and what differentiates us from much of the world is diversity, is a commitment to pluralism, is we're a big tent that includes people from every life experience, from every background, and part of our commitment to promoting pluralism is fighting against extremism in every form, including anti-Semitism. And I worry about the creeping anti-Semitism here in the United States and elsewhere in the world, which has taken the form of a delegitimation campaign against Israel. And as an elected official who considers himself a pluralist, I feel deeply obligated to resist extremism in every form, including anti-Semitism.
So what are the contemporary challenges and even threats to this Omni-American vision?
Well, the threats are coming from every direction. I mean, there's extremism from the far right in the form of white nationalism, and there's extremism in the far left in the form of anti-Zionism, the denying the right of the Jewish people to self-determination, denying the right of Israel to defend itself. There's a propaganda war on the very legitimacy and the very existence of Israel. There's an ugly undercurrent that underlies the demonization of Israel and the insistence on erasing the Jewish struggle for liberation and the Jewish experience of oppression.
Sir, Murray recognized that in life, both chaos and repressive orders are always possible. Do you think Americans possess the resilience to recognize liberal forces for what they are and to respond accordingly?
I do. I have faith in the resilience of the United States. We're the most durable republic in the history of humankind. We remain the most powerful country in the world, but we cannot take for granted the inevitable success of liberal democracy. We have to be vigilant in defending it from threats, not only abroad, but within our own ranks here at home. And I worry about the rising illiberalism and extremism of the far right and the far left, and those of us in the middle should feel deeply committed to defending liberal democracy, which is fragile, but can not only survive, but succeed with our vigilance.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Aria, you want to add something?
No, just that it's so important and right on the mark.
Definitely. All right. Thank you again for your service, Congressman Torres. And of course, congratulations again on receiving this award.
It's an honor to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Greg Thomas, my good friend, the amazing, the wonderful Greg Thomas, are you with us?
I sure am.
All right. So, Greg, take it away.
Well, I tell you, this has been some 2 days, and I am honored to have been a part of planning it. I so thank you, Aryeh, for not just working on this project, but for your deep friendship, a friendship that's based on our shared love of the work of Murray and Ellison, Stanley, and the music of Duke and Basie and Winton and Donald Harrison and Itamar and others, but also based on a strong spiritual and moral grounding. And I think we share in an aspiration for excellence, a word that keeps coming up, because when we talk about jazz, when we talk about American democracy, when we talk about what it takes to overcome anti-Semitism, racism, and other forms of bigotry and hatred, it will truly take excellence on all levels, but it'll also take wisdom. We're not just talking about technical skills. In jazz, having the technical skills and just being a virtuoso in terms of your ability on your instrument, that's a good place to be, but it's not the ultimate. Ultimately, we have to strive for wisdom. What we need is truly a wise way of dealing with the existential threats and the complexities that are before us. And what we find in this blues idiom wisdom tradition, what we find in the work of Albert Murray and some of the other thinkers that we've been dealing with, what we find in the work of many of our guests and participants, and we so thank them for being a part of this, is a shared desire to help us as individuals to be poised, balanced in ourselves, in our individuality. Each of us has an individual fingerprint and footprint, but also to learn how to more wisely interact and commune and communicate with each other. And so if more of us will have this wise way of being and interacting and striving for, which is this omni-American future that we're trying to shape, we're gonna be the better for it, which is why this is just the beginning. This is the first inaugural event where not only next year do we plan to have another with more guests and more awards and such, we're going to have things in between to keep this going. So I just want to thank the support of Jason Guberman of ASF, American Sephardi Federation, Sasha of CAM, Combat Anti-Semitism Movement, and to our wonderful host, Lauren, thank you for doing such a great job.
Thank you so much, Greg. Aryeh?
So our ride through Albert Murray's Omni-American vision and the blues idiom wisdom tradition is coming to an end. I hope you enjoyed the journey. I also hope that you can take a few ideas with you. For instance, as I recently wrote in Moment magazine, we need to acknowledge that a society without bigotry is a utopian dream. Bigotry is foolish. Why cut yourself off from potential sources of human excellence? But as the great Czech novelist Milan Kundera said in his 1985 Jerusalem address, stupidity does not give way to science, technology, modernity, or progress. On the contrary, it progresses right along with progress. There's no easy solution to bigotry, and Murray accordingly advises us to moderate our expectations from the political realm, but to raise our aspirations for ourselves. Yes, bigotry needs to be fought, but Murray reminds us that we should embrace the battle as an opportunity to stomp the blue devils. Again, we've been celebrating and exploring Murray's thought and writings throughout this event, but if we're being honest, the fact that myself and other people who are light-skinned embrace Murray and the blues idiom wisdom tradition isn't so easy for some people to digest. So before we conclude, I want to squarely face two objections. First of all, there is the issue of cultural appropriation. Why have light-skinned Jewish people been talking about Albert Murray? In order to answer this question, imagine Murray smiling his broad, mischievous smile, a light sparkling in his eyes and laughing, why not? You learn the vocabulary. That's how culture works. Again, to quote Miles Davis, I don't care if a dude is purple with green breath as long as he can swing. Besides, if we're going down the path of cultural appropriation, then let's go down that path to begin with. Everybody's got to stop saying amen and hallelujah. Those are Hebrew words, and I don't remember anyone asking for permission. You really want to go down the road of cultural appropriation? Then put Islam and Christianity back inside the box. But again, that's not our path. I say take all the hallelujahs that you need. More praise for the Creator, please. The other form of resistance comes from closer to home. It's difficult for some to see a Jewish man joyfully celebrating the wisdom of Albert Murray. It can appear servile. As in, why are you grazing in foreign pastures? Why are you turning to this tradition and neglecting your own? My response to this is that I passionately love learning Torah in all of its forms, and I deeply love Shabbat, 25 blessed hours off the digital grid, communing with my family, community, and Creator. And it has become clear to me through years of often interrupted but nevertheless constant learning that the absurd wealth of our tradition has been acquired through what Rabbi Ben-Sion Meir Hayuziel, the first Sephardi chief rabbi of Israel, called the exceedingly strong receptive power of the nation of Israel. This is a receptive power that has absorbed different forms of human vitality and excellence from around the globe by instinctively and consciously following Maimonides' directive to Isma al-Haq miman kalahu, or in Hebrew, Shema emet mimisha umra, in English, to hear the truth from whoever says it. Our tradition has always developed in line with this principle. After all, Chazal, the sages, teach explicitly that if someone says they found wisdom in the world, believe them. And that's what we've been celebrating and exploring together, the blues idiom wisdom tradition. Moving forward, to the skeptics I offer, why not join us and listen? So in conclusion, I need to say some thank yous. Thank you to everyone who tuned in to watch. Thank you to all of our amazing speakers and participants, including the great Itamar Borochov Quartet. Thank you to our wonderful moderator, Lauren. Thank you to Sasha, the executive director at the Combat Anti-Semitism Movement, and his fantastic professional team, Arthur, Ila, Barney, and Catherine. Thank you to Jason Guberman, the visionary executive director of the American Sephardi Federation, for envisioning the partnership between the ASF, CAM, and the Jazz Leadership Project. Thank you to Greg Thomas, the great Greg Thomas, my good friend, one of the most special souls in the world, a man who has a unique combination of an entrepreneurial spirit and artistic sensibility. I could go on for a long time, but this, he's my partner and co-organizer, and this is only the beginning, my friend. Thank you to my beloved and dearly departed father and mother, Yichiel ben Metetyahu and Miriam bat Tila, who raised me and my siblings to passionately believe in racial equality. Their spirit has been present at this event. And finally, thank you to El Elohei Israel, the God of Israel, who is also the God of every rock, animal, human being, and the entire cosmos, for teaching us in your Torah that every human being is created in your image, not the cosmos or the sun or the moon or the stars, but human beings. All human beings are the image of the divine in this world. And if not for your Torah, we wouldn't know that. But before we, human beings, that is, get too excited and start patting ourselves on the back, let's remember that we're only the image. Being created in the image of divinity is a challenge. It's up to us to aspire to excellence, to greatness, and to become channels for deep soulfulness to flow into the world.
First, I would like again warmly congratulate our award winners, Winton Marsalis yesterday and Congressman Richie Torres today. Both embody the Omni-American principle envisioned by Albert Murray in his writing, and we are honored to recognize them for their achievement as true leaders, Marsalis in the world of jazz and Congressman Torres in the world of politics. These events mark a critical turning point in how we look at the collective fight against bigotry and hatred. Jewish and Black Americans have suffered enough from prejudice and amid rising antisemitism and racism. The time is now to chart a new path forward together. We must embrace the power of culture to transcend traditional divides and build bridges to better share future, both in the United States and around the world. The Omni-American Future initiative is a pilot program to harness common values and show the world that we can do better together. We're never gonna allow anyone to tell us, as Jews, who we are and what we should think, and neither should Black Americans. We are proud of our identity and cherish what unites us. I want to thank you, partner organization that made this event impactful and a success that will continue for long. So the American Sephardic Federation and the Jazz Leadership Project. I would like to thank all the speakers that took the time to share wise insight and smart thoughts. I would like to thank also Itamar Borchow Quartet for the wonderful music that helped us understanding the world with music. It was wonderful, so thank you very much. But this event, as Greg said, was only the starting point of something bigger that we are trying to build. So let's do it together. Let's change the way that people look at us and make the world a better place for all. So thank you very much, and I would like to invite everyone that would like to take a part in this movement to join us. Visit our website and join this wonderful movement that will change the world. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sasha, and thank you to all the organizers of this wonderful event. And with that, we've reached the conclusion of this groundbreaking two-day broadcast. We hope you have been energized to do what you can to push back against racism and antisemitism. We want you to be part of the movement. Visit the Omni-American website, register for future programs, and participate in our initiatives. If you missed anything today or yesterday, don't fret. You'll get an email recap and a recording of the full event will be available at event.omniamerican.org, so write it down, as well as on the Combat Antisemitism Movement's social media channels. Partner organizations that helped make this event possible include the JCC Association of North America, Foundation Against Intolerance and Racism, Lantos Foundation, National Jazz Museum, Free Black Thought, Jewish Institute for Liberal Values, and Jazz Mobile, among others. The power of culture over racial essentialism, this event as a cultural complement and extension of the relationship between Jewish and Black Americans found in the civil rights movement and the Omni-American embrace of the many and the one have been themes throughout our time together over the last couple of days. The beauty and power of jazz music has been another, which is why we'll conclude with music by Itamar Borchow, of course. Thank you for being with us today, and we hope to see you again soon. Now, music, maestro. Thank you.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more. Simply visit the JBS website at jbstv.org and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check to JBS, Post Office Box 360, Stamford, Connecticut 06904. Or you can call the JBS Pledge Line at 833-MY-JBS-TV. That's 833-695-2788. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. We thank you for your kind support.